this is fun. I feel like a true university professor. Thank you all, the organizers of this extraordinary conference, and to all the participants. And special thanks to Okui, where are you? I need to look at you while I'm talking, for gathering us here for 4 days of conversation and learning, and for the force of your intellect and curatorial vision. That with this conference and exhibition unpacks the profound and shifting complexities of art, politics, and ideologies of the post-war era. I have been struck over the last few days by how few papers deal with the war that conditions the post-war. The periodization of post-war is enduring. And the enduring coupling of war with both the geopolitics and the culture that followed the putative end of World War II in 1945 is a question that should be at the heart of our project. What we have learned, of course, is that there was no single war and no single post-war experience. There were tens, if not hundreds, of wars, most originating in the late 19th century when colonial empires from the Pacific to the Atlantic were using military might to gain territories on land and at sea, literally all over the globe. By 1931, when the Japanese invaded and colonized Manchuria, allegedly for resources to fuel its rapid industrialization, conditions were ripe for independence wars from the British, for the Nazi rise in Germany, and for civil war in China between Mao Zedong's CCP and the Kuomintang's and Chiang Kai-shek's Kuomintang. But if we have multiple wars that conditioned multiple post-wars, we also have multiple histories that nations have produced to glorify, justify, or display guilt for the carnage. These official histories, narrated in textbooks, museum exhibitions, war memorials, and political speech, communicated the message of what was lost and what was gained. Today, I would like to argue that these post-war histories of war were not really histories at all. Rather, they were, and they are, discursive constructions created by the state to serve political and ideological ends in the advancing Cold War. The case of Japan is extraordinary in this regard. The atomic bombs of August 1945 compelled the unconditional surrender and defeat of the Empire of Japan to the Allied forces, effectively ending World War II long after, literally almost a year after, its Axis allies, Italy, which surrendered in fall of 1944, and Germany, which surrendered in spring of 1945, had given up battle. Driven by militarist ideology and the dream of a unified Asia under the Yamato race, wartime Japan ruled over nearly 3 million square miles of the Asia-Pacific region, making it one of the largest empires in history. It was also one of the most brutal. The iconic image of the atomic bomb blast, which we've seen over the last few days, over Hiroshima, Nagasaki, is rarely imagined, has achieved one of the weirdest perversions of war history ever. Virtually overnight, it defined the Japanese people as victims of unspeakable horror perpetrated by the dual evils of modern Western science and U.S. imperialism over the inferior yellow race. This view obliterated the inconvenient facts that Japan itself was an advanced war machine directed by a fascist totalitarian state that was responsible for the deaths of 20 million Asians, including some 15 million Chinese, 3.1 million Japanese, and more than 60,000 soldiers of the Western Allied forces. That's impressive, even in World War II. The story of post-war Japan is thus the story of how Japan's history and memory of the war were officially erased. What's weirder still is that this total reimagining of Japan was deliberately produced by the US government. The US entered World War II only on December 7th, 1941, years after its European allies and, of course, the Jewish people had hoped the US would enter the war. But it wasn't until Pearl Harbor and the attack on its Pacific fleet that the US entered the war. Its defeat of Japan meant the reestablishment of the US as a Pacific power. The occupation of General MacArthur lost no time in co-opting its former enemy as Japan's principal ally and military station in the rising Pacific front of the Cold War and eventually, indeed, the war in Indochina. China fell to Mao in 1949, and the Korean War of 1951 led to the division of the Korean Peninsula, with the North falling to Soviet influence. Today, I would like to review the history of Japan at war. You're going to see a lot of maps in order to appreciate the extent of the discursive construction that erased that history in the post-war period. What comes to light is how American elite academies, working closely with the Department of State and its client, the ruling LDP party in Japan, successfully recast the image of Japan from an aggressor to a victim nation. Secondly, I would like to show how post-war Japanese society also did an about-face and embraced America's influence. Demilitarized and in the throes of rapid reconstruction, Japan's culture of defeat actually thrived in a swamp of ambiguity. On one hand, artists and writers rejected America's ideological inventions of a pacified, effeminized, and contemplative Japan. On the other, they deliberately internalized what Gutai founder Yoshihara Jiro called the psychological realism of American humanism, expressed in its avant-garde art. The polarity of what I call Godzilla's schizophrenia. This polarity is what I call Godzilla's schizophrenia. That's pretty good, don't you think? It's no coincidence, Ming, that this great monster movie picturing catastrophic violence, material destruction, and atomic aberration on a truly giant scale was released in 1954, the year Gutai was founded. So, there we are, Hirohito at Disneyland. And a few years earlier, the Emperor of Japan on the cover of Time magazine. In 2001, the historian Herbert Bix published the book Hirohito and the Making of Modern Japan. Drawing on long taboo material that had recently come to light after Hirohito's death in 1989, Hirohito was the first biography of the modern emperor to ascribe war responsibility to this curious man who had been the center of fanatical national worship since his enthronement as a living deity in 1928. The Economist called Bix's book a historical bombshell. It won the Pulitzer and the National Book Critics Award in the US and was a very controversial bestseller in Japan. Bix wrote, "Above all, the new materials make it possible for us to appreciate how Hirohito embodied, as no other Japanese did, the contradictory logic of Japan's entire modern political development." Hirohito, known posthumously as Emperor Showa in the name of his 63-year reign, inherited this mantle and the mandate from his grandfather, Emperor Meiji the Great. On becoming emperor in 1968 and entering this kind of world of colonial accession, Meiji was made to serve as the pole star of the nation's modern transformation. The imperial court was separated from the government according to models of European monarchy. The Meiji Constitution asserted the emperor was the successor in an unbroken sacred blood lineage and cast the emperor as sacred and inviolable, head of the empire and supreme commander of the armed forces. He was monarch, god, and commander in chief. And what we need to appreciate is that this idea of the emperor was a complete invention of the Meiji state. Just decades before, the Edo emperors were so poor, they were seen on the streets of Kyoto selling scraps of their calligraphy. So here's the map of the first Sino-Japanese War that Hirohito's grandfather, Emperor Meiji, inaugurated with relish just a decade after the so-called modernization of Japan began after the overthrow of the Bakufu in 1868. So the Meiji legacy was Japan's new colonial empire and status as a formidable regional power. So while most of the rest of the world fell under the control of advanced Western powers, Japan alone among the non-Christian, non-white nations emulated them, competing for and winning Asian colonies. With the first Sino-Japanese War of 1894 to 95, China lost and ceded Formosa, Taiwan, which became Japan's first colony. China was made to pay an enormous indemnity and sign an unequal commercial treaty. Victory on this scale to a newly modern and industrialized and militarized nation stimulated xenophobic nationalism among the Japanese and a sense of racial, moral, and cultural superiority over China and Korea, a legacy that survives to this very day. Triumph over Tsarist Russia in 1905 after a sensational victory at sea further secured Japan's hold over Manchuria, the Liaotong Peninsula, and the southern half of the Sakhalin Island in the Sea of Okhotsk, which to this day is still disputed. In 1910, the Japanese overthrew the Joseon Dynasty king in Korea, and the annexation of the Korean Peninsula was secured as its second colony in the region. In World War I, Japan joined the Allied side, moving against German holdings in China, and was rewarded by being seated as one of the big five nations at the Versailles Peace Conference, where victors meant to punish Germany and rearrange the world. Again, no other non-white, non-Christian people at the time could have imagined playing the great game of global power and influence at this level. Of course, it was also at the Versailles Conference where they were denied racial equality. The transfer of German rights to Shandong to Japan at the Versailles Peace Conference enraged the Chinese public. The Chinese viewed the transfer as a betrayal by the Western powers and also as a symbol of mounting Japanese aggression. And infuriated by this humiliation, of course, the May 4th movement was launched with massive demonstrations on May 4th, 1919 in Beijing. And of course, the ensuing May 4th movement marked an intellectual turning point in China itself, where collectively the goal of scholars and students was to rid Chinese culture of those elements which they believe had led to China's stagnation and weakness, and to create new values for a new modern China, including the overthrow of its own weak and corrupt Republican government and including, top of the list, resistance against Japan. They didn't fare so well. As colonial expansion continued with ever-increasing military resources, Japanese political ideology centered around a new spiritually driven and powerful nationalism called the Imperial Way. And here you see a Japanese newspaper of the Nanking Massacre, where a soldier is celebrating himself and being celebrated for having killed 100 people, Chinese people, on a single day. And this was considered a great victory. The term Kodo, or Imperial Way, denoted a kind of holy war against Western doctrines, democracy, liberalism, individualism, and communism. The Imperial Way also promoted Shinto impulses to purify Asia from the polluting influences of Anglo-American political culture, and to eradicate those who resisted its divine mandate to unify, quote, the eight corners of the world under the, quote, benevolent morality, of the emperor deity responsible for this horrific Nanking Massacre. At the peak of its expansion in 1942, Japan bestrode Asia like a colossus, one foot planted in the mid-Pacific, the other deep in the interior of China, and its grasp reaching north to the Aleutian Islands and south to the western colonial enclaves of Southeast Asia. Japan's East Asia co-prosperity sphere, which it happily named itself, briefly included the Dutch East Indies, French Indochina, the British colonial possessions of Burma, Malaya, Hong Kong, and the American colony of the Philippines. At home, poets, priests, and propagandists alike extolled the superiority of the Yamato race and the supreme destiny of the Imperial Way. By 1943, it was clear their mission was doomed. Younger and younger Japanese troops, wait a minute, I'm lost. Where am I? Did you get the tripartite commission? Okay, anyway. Younger and younger Japanese troops, sorry, I'm a little behind myself. Okay, so I wanted to just walk you through all these happy war images. So here we are with the attack of Pearl Harbor, Singapore advance in 1942, and the rape of Manila in the Philippines in 1942. And here at the peak of the Japanese empire is a map of the globe in 1942 with colonies, mandates, and puppet states, protectorates, and occupied territories. And here is the beginning of the collapse of the Japanese empire that really begins with the defeat of Midway by U.S. Navy in the spring of 1942, just 6 months after Pearl Harbor. But by 1943, it was clear this holy war mission was doomed. Younger and younger Japanese troops died in hopeless kamikaze suicide attacks, died of starvation like these soldiers in the field. They killed their own wounded and murdered their civilian compatriots in Saipan and Okinawa. But Hirohito, weirdly, was oblivious. Here he is walking in the ruins of Tokyo after the worst firebombs in the history of human warfare, much worse than any German city had survived. 250,000 civilians, more than double what were killed in both Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and an enormous amount of urban devastation, which left Tokyo virtually razed as Hiroshima and Nagasaki would be later that year. But Hirohito marched on again months after the surrender of the other Axis powers. So the Americans came in with force, bombing with their famous B-52 bombers up to 66 cities across all four of the Japanese archipelago islands. Still, Japan would not surrender. Still, it delayed any tactic, any idea to end the war. So, enter the atomic bomb, enter little boy. And the first blast over Hiroshima. Denying the threat of defeat even after the first bomb, Hirohito and the military leaders vow to fight on till the 100 million all die like shattered jewels. And in Herbert Bick's book, using an enormous amount of new scholarly material, he actually records the 3 days between August 6th and August 9th when the second bomb was dropped. Have you ever wondered why two bombs were dropped? And they were up there in Tokyo asking themselves and demanding of the military leaders how long it would take for Japan to create an atomic bomb. And the military advisors told Hirohito until October. And Hirohito, still on August 7th, and still on August 8th, and still until the morning of August 9th, said, let's carry on. Here we have Hiroshima, and of course here we have Nagasaki, which few people realize was actually a Christian city. And the epicenter of the bomb, ironically or not, was the Urigami Cathedral, the oldest cathedral in Japan, and the site of Japan's largest Catholic population. And here, of course, finally, later in August of 1945, is the surrender on the USS Missouri. Wait a minute. Sorry. I lost myself. Okay. Right. Okay. So, there's World War II. 40 nations, total battle deaths, total battle wounded, and total civilian deaths. And this is the outcome in Japan. The occupation of Japan began in 1945 under General MacArthur and ended in April 1952, though some argue Japan's post-war and occupation era lasted until Hirohito's death in 1989. Immediately on arrival, the occupying power over their defeated, immediately on arrival as the occupying power over their defeated enemy, the Americans imposed an all-out campaign of demilitarization and democratization. Demilitarization meant the renunciation of war. Literally, as Article 9 pronounced in the Japanese Constitution drafted by the US occupation forces, the dismantling of the military industry, the renunciation of war, and a war tribunal that succeeded in winning Japanese support for this very move that was enshrined in Article 9, and that is, by the way, again being debated by Abe in Japan today. I want to go back to this photograph, which is absolutely iconic and absolutely famous, because in this image that was widely circulated in the Japanese newspapers, we see MacArthur, the head of the occupation forces, arriving with his hands in the pocket for this formal portrait, in his fatigues, with the Japanese emperor looking exceedingly stiff, showing up in his tails, but none of his military regalia, and none of his regalia of his enthronement as emperor and deity of Japan. And in a move that is still being debated, and which also some of the recent scholarship really unpacks, is why did MacArthur keep Hirohito in power when in every other country, especially in, of course, Germany, the war tribunals virtually eradicated the entire class of military leaders who had been responsible and political leaders who had been responsible for the war if they hadn't already committed suicide. And there's a very interesting whole discourse on what were the motivations for MacArthur's rather radical choice, and in retrospect, maybe a mistaken one. The occupation has long been criticized for its imperialist conceits, of course, and for its crude and forced Americanization of every variety of political, ideological, and cultural institution. Here, perhaps, we need to introduce another term in our periodization of the post-war experience, namely post-surrender. What's often called in Japan the occupation era is really a post-surrender period, and its conditions are very particular and shape the conditions for what becomes an elongated, extended post-war. This post-surrender period of 1945 to 1952 created the conditions for and the consciousness of Japan's response to Americanization. Moves between the Japanese embrace of and resistance against its Western victor define what I call its national psychic identity of schizophrenia. In John Dower's revisionist history, Embracing Defeat, which came out in 1999, and it too won the Pulitzer, Japan in the wake of World War II emerges as a culture in sensuous embrace with America. This turnabout comes about because of Japan's appreciation, sincere and genuine appreciation of one, its liberation from totalitarianism, which this cartoon is showing, the chains of totalitarianism being cut by the giant shears of America, with the old guard, the Mitsubishi old guard, and the militarists running away as fast as they can. Number two, its renunciation of militarism, which was also very significant for a country that had literally been at war since 1894. And thirdly, America was embraced for its cult of the new in all realms of social, cultural, and even political expressions that entered into the Japanese parlance. In this reading, the U.S. acts as an agent for freedom of expression, including the loosening of sexual mores and the practice of avant-garde art in the years after censorship. And that coupling is not as crazy as it might seem, because at the core of this it was a new embrace of carnal violence and total passion of the individual mind. Kato, by the way, just going back to this, was ironically during the war a foremost cartoonist for the propaganda, creating all kinds of anti-American and anti-Allied imagery. But overnight, he became the leading cartoonist and most popular cartoonist supporting these efforts of democratization and demilitarization. And in this one, what it's saying here is this was an okureta kakume, which means it was a received revolution, as if it had come from above, manna from heaven, that this militarized totalitarian society after this disastrous and forever war had been given a revolution of freedom. And here you have on the writing here the People's Revolution. As part of this immediate post-war surrender culture of defeat, you also had an amazing group of writers, intellectuals, and intellectuals emerge, including Sakaguchi Ando, Osamu Dazai, and Tamuro Taijiro. The post-war surrender years saw another development that would define Japan's particular and brilliant post-war counterculture, including manifestations like Utai. Existentialism and nihilism were popular among artists and intellectuals who argued that the recent war had not only wrecked civilization, it had wrecked the absolute value of all systems of truth. That's important. Sakaguchi Ando's 1946 essay on decadence and Osamu Dazai's 1948 novel, The Setting Sun, examine what Sakakura calls the illusion, the empty bubble of love in the midst of that appalling destruction. In place of the chimera of emperor worship, Japan is now a festering spectacle of decadence. Sakagura goes on, Japan was defeated and the samurai ethic has perished, but humanity has been born from the womb of decadence truth. And key to this decadence and key to this new genuine passion and key to the idea of what a new humanism was constituted of was the primacy of individual carnal acts of passion. And these writers, and eventually we'll see the Gutai also, were extolling the truth and honesty of Nikutai, or flesh, as opposed to the delusions of abstract thought or idea she saw. And also as opposed to, of course, the polity of Kokutai, which literally means the body of the nation, which had been the polity that had run the Japanese ideology of the empire for so many decades. So it was flesh versus country, the individual again versus the state. Ironically, for the occupation forces, one of the unforeseen developments in the post-surrender period was the return and rise of Marxism and the huge popularity of the newly restituted Japanese Communist Party. As the only ones who could claim having resisted ultra-nationalism in the 1930s, Marxists had sudden special status among the post-war intelligentsia and its deepening community of remorse. Defeat helped establish Marxism and the Communist Party in the 1947-48 period as beacons of secular universal principles that transcended the disastrous values of the imperial state. And one of the outcomes of the Marxists were the beginning of real, again, remorse over Hirohito's role in the war. And here we see a cartoon of Hirohito standing in a kind of globe of human skulls, a very taboo subject even then under the military occupation, which was working hard to restitute Hirohito as one who was oblivious to war efforts and had only been a puppet to the militarists and to Tojo. But nonetheless, it was the communists who were calling for truth, who were crying for historical truth at this time when the Americans were already working to erase that truth. What the U.S. could not foresee or control was the radical fervor which would drive the dominant intellectual class to call upon the very American Revolution it had brought on to go beyond its own boundaries of bourgeois democracy. The communists and Marxists argued, and by the way, by the late 40s, early 50s, they dominated the academy, especially Tokyo University. They argued that genuine democracy required a clear sense of selfhood or autonomous subjectivity. Only then could individuals stand against the obliterating powers of the state. America, of course, responded by purging thousands of intellectuals, academics, and labor leaders and communists, thus setting the stage for its so-called reverse course and losing the good faith that it had initially established when it first arrived on the shores of Japan 5 or 6 years earlier. And here I want to talk about one great artist, the photographer Tomatsu Shome, who emerged from this swamp of ambiguity in the mid-1950s as really one of Japan's first greatest art documentary photographers. In this climate, artists who had once embraced Japan now turned their critical lens against the liberators. And in Tomatsu's series, which initially was called Occupation and then was called Americanization, and he ended up calling the series Chewing Gum and Chocolate after what the American soldiers were famous for in their first arrival to Japan, which they scattered around to Japanese children. So the themes were military occupation, prostitution, and here probably a cross-dressing prostitute. Themes around Yokosuka, the great military base that has been the subject of so much political critique and social revolution as the largest military base right in the environs of Tokyo, also a nuclear base. And also, it was Tomatsu who first, at the invitation and under and funded by a Soviet group calling for a kind of grassroots nuclear freeze, it was he who first went to Nagasaki and documented the long-censored record of atomic radiation on the hibakusha, or victims of Nagasaki, again, all of whom had been Catholic, or still were Catholic. This is them with their distorted and grotesque keloid scars. And here is the Cathedral of Uragami, smashed as the epicenter of the Nagasaki bomb. And here is one of Tomatsu's most iconic and searing images from his series 1102, titled after a frozen stopwatch that he photographed as well. Now I want to move to America's discursive construction of post-war Japan. This book by Ruth Benedict, The Chrysanthemum and the Sword, is absolutely a classic. It was commissioned by the Office of War Information from an social anthropologist as part of an ongoing attempt to better understand the enemy in order to wage a successful war and administer the occupation. Her study grew out of a dominant practice of social science that emphasized holistic views of societies called the culture and personality school, which favored typologizing national characteristics as enduring and transnational determinations of collective behavior. Benedict used this method to cast the Japanese as a shame culture that placed primacy on society's conformist values, as opposed to the West's culture of guilt and its privileging of interiority and conscience. Basically, the group culture of Japan and conformist culture of Japan versus individualism of the West. The implications of this popular theory were vast and extended to Japanese representations of themselves in the post-surrender and throughout the post-war period. It posited Japan as unique, declared that individualism was hopeless because you were genetically unable to ever get there, and bonded and passed the buck on war accountability to national characteristics of social harmony and conformity. In his essay, Disciplining the Enemy, Area Studies and the Relocation of Japan, the intellectual historian Harry Harutunian demonstrates how Benedict's book and an entire industry of American academic study on Japan was, quote, inaugurally bonded to the state and its necessity. And this relationship was to mark the subsequent formation of a field of knowledge that sought to fix Japan as a signified. Of course, the collusion of state, business, and the academy in the formation and dissemination of Japan as a subject of knowledge was made possible by what Harutunian calls the wartime cohort. Men who served in the American occupation as translators, interrogators, or gatherers of military intelligence, and others like Edwin Reischauer, who became Japan specialists by virtue of their military origins. This was a cohort of academics. Reischauer was first dean of Japanese studies at Harvard. Is that telling me something? And later, of course, our ambassador to Japan, note the collusion between the Academy, Harvard, the Center of East Asian Studies, and the ambassador of Japan in the early 1960s. Yale, Harvard, Princeton, Stanford, all of these together produced series of collective studies that culminated in major textbooks during the 1960s. They created a discursive construction that imposed a set of essentialist characteristics on Japanese society, culture, and its historical trajectory, and then reproduced this version of Japan in the U.S. Academy, the Department of State, and even in our museums. In this version, Japan was represented as effeminized, as pacifized, and as contemplative. And look at the image that Reischauer uses on the Reischauer, Fairbank, and Craig use on their massive textbook of East Asia, a very pretty landscape, a nice little Rinpa landscape, all gold and empty of people. In his own story of the nation, Reischauer, who, like many of these guys of the Warhol cohort, was married to a Japanese, very convenient for their work. I wish I were married to a Japanese, a woman. He chooses, again, this totally obsequious, you know, image of Japanese nature. Japanese are nature-loving. Japanese, this also, D.C. Suzuki kind of falls into this and is also somehow weirdly complicit in this projection and reproduction of Japan as a contemplative, zen-loving, pacifist kind of culture that produces disembodied, monochrome works that do nothing but promote ideals of man as one and unified with nature. What I am arguing, sorry, I keep losing myself. What I am arguing here is that these totalizing ideologies created by the U.S. and adopted by the Japanese became an alternative force against which the avant-garde had to resist. In a moment, and it's truly a moment, I will offer a new interpretation of Gutai art as a reaction against this discursive construction to tame the beast. One of the more insidious legacies was the cohort's modernization theory. This invention cast Japan's development since the Meiji as a nice, clean, linear development, linear progressive realization of a modern capitalist and industrialized democracy. The only problem with this happy story was the war. Reischauer then offered his so-called derailment theory that also became standard history in the academy and that was swallowed whole by the Japanese. And in this version of the war and militarism and Japan's empire, Japan had been derailed from its happy Meiji modernization by a small group of militarists led by Tojo, who somehow co-opted the poor innocent Emperor Hirohito and led the country into this disastrous but most uncharacteristic display of violence and aggression. Such balm anesthetized the Japanese from dealing with the uneven and violent aspects of their individual and national psyches, past and present. Enter Godzilla. This monster born of nuclear mishap in the Pacific, who lashes his way to the shores of Japan in 1954 and wreaks spectacular destruction on its cities and populations, was designed to conjure Japan's recent wartime experience of massive firebombs, atomic holocaust, and the censored memory of so many wretched deaths. It also represents, as Takashi Murakami taught us in Little Boy, the show we curated at Japan Society, it represented a subculture of violence that was beginning to seethe through all membranes of Japanese society. Everything the Americans feared and loathed, and turned Bury trauma into a monstrous fantasy of grotesque aberration on a monumental level. But who is Godzilla? The US or Japan's own past? Going to spend the last 2 minutes or so speaking about Gutai. And as Ming and I have often spoke, we learn so much from producing a show. When you have the privilege of living with your project, you can't help but have afterthoughts. And we often spoke to each other that we need to, all shows, and yours too, Okoye, needs to have a kind of, you know, post-mortem. It needs to have, what did we learn from the show? What were its flaws, and what was it? What was incomplete about the project? And in our show, we explored very consciously themes connected to the historical context of post-war Japan and its emergence on the world stage. We were interested in Japan's sort of right of internationalism, its ideology of internationalism. Secondly, in what Ming's brilliant contribution was, its ethics of freedom and individualism in a post-totalitarian state, and also Ming's contribution to the idea of play and the influence of children as agents of the unfettered mind and as citizens of a future Japan that would be totally free of totalitarian and conformist thought. I would like to return to these themes and see them in a slightly different light, focusing on Yoshihata's articulation of aberration, his battle cry to do what nobody has done before, in the specific context of the polarizing seduction of and repulsion towards America and the war in his own and Gutai's post-war imaginary. So here we are with our themes of internationalization, of course, the famous encounter with Tapie. And here we have the two paintings in the great 1957 show of Pollock and Yoshihata's painting in the historic show of the international art of a new era, Aphromel and Gutai. And here we have a wonderful picture of the founding of Gutai, also thematizing Gutai's splendid playground theme of Gutai as play, Gutai as liberation. And here in one of our favorite works, Yoshihata's own Please Draw Freely, which again Ming argues, and we argue together, a kind of way to, on this white, totally blank slate, for individuals to create their own imaginary, to create and mark their own selves. But it was really an encounter, first with the Bokubi group of calligraphers, avant-garde calligraphers that were active in the Kansai area around the time Gutai itself was forming, that's the early 1950s. Yoshihata was a member of this group and joined often in contributing essays to its eponymous magazine, the cover of its first journal being indeed a work by Franz Klein. It's not the moment to get into Bokubi, but what's interesting is that Yoshihata, in participating in this discourse of how tradition, calligraphy, and the sort of Zen principle of direct action, of violent direct action of the body and material to create and perform a work of art, bypassing the rational mind, he eventually rejects this because he feels that it is too much cast, possibly, in this American construction of Japan as a Japan without rupture. Where he finds rupture is in his encounter with this exact painting by Jackson Pollock in a show in Japan, in Osaka, in 1951. And he writes that it is perhaps Pollock alone who emblemizes a raw psychological realism that could be at the heart of a new humanism that he, Yoshihara, would now go on to found and to express with his younger cohorts, the Gutai artists, who joined him in late 1954 and early 1955. In a series of radical, outrageous, remarkable artistic and performative acts. It's true, and we have occasional texts where this idea of Gutai as a force against totalitarianism and upending of totalitarianism is proven. But what if these concrete acts, and remember that Gutai means concretes, what if these concrete acts meant something else than what we have thought about for so long? What if their bodily violence and material destruction represent more than the legacies of Japan's wartime experience and its past totalitarian controls? What if they arose also as resistance against the present configurations of their post-war society and polity? They are born from the belly of the beast, but revolt against its diseased nurture. They are beasts that cannot be tamed. It's not insignificant that when Gutai was asked to produce a series of photographs for Life magazine, it chose to stage its one day only outdoor exhibition in the ruins of a US bombed out food oil refinery that had been owned by Yoshihara's family. And this desolate image was meant to be projected to the Americans as the site of Gutai creativity. And as a final note, to circle back to what we were discussing on the first day with Majella's talk, I wanted to end with a nod to Takashi Murakami and his little boy, who brought to our attention this TV series that had 108 episodes during the 1960s. And at the end of every Saturday morning cartoon, the world blows up in a nice, colorful atomic bomb. But you know what? The enemies are wholly restored in the following installments. Thank you.
I have to say I love your reconsideration of those constructed narrative. I think that's really to the point, and then we often overlook, and then I really appreciate the way you mapped out. The only thing is, in that picture, in my understanding, Yoshihara is pro-Americanist, right?
In my picture or in his picture?
In my picture.
Yeah.
In my understanding, because before he saw his appreciation, Yoshihara's appreciation of Pollock came out as the kind of string of the pro-American milieu, the events. In 1950, 1 year before, there was something called America Fair in Osaka, mm-hmm. in which American paintings were shown, about which he said, I feel kinship to those artists, more so than those Japanese modernists. And then that's open. Obviously, and then along with that, he talked about the American education system vis-a-vis Japanese, the American commercial culture, commercial art culture, and so on and so forth. Even his understanding of surrealism is shaded by Dalí's involvement with the American commercial culture. So it seems, of course, he was struck by the form and the materiality and then the sheer power of Pollock's painting. There's no doubt about that. But the the good painting doesn't impress anybody, you know, unconditionally, I have to say, because when Yoshihara was so impressed by Pollock, nobody else in Japan was impressed. They were all gaga about what we saw yesterday of Salon Dome, the Serge showed the certain the French abstractions. Those are the things they were so gaga about. So his view was really shaped by his own kind of understanding of America, rather than as new, actually, as you said, cult of new. So
I want to say in this company that I owe so much of my intellectual work in the study of Japan to Reiko Tomie. Our partnership and intellectual camaraderie go back to 1989 when we found ourselves in New York at the newly established and ultimately short-lived Center for International Contemporary Art, itself a rather radical idea in 1989, and worked together on the Kusama retrospective. So I just have to say that. So thank you, Reiko. I think the whole point I'm making is that it is this duality, it is this schizophrenia, it is an embrace and a revulsion. And definitely, and in my writing too, and Ming was, you know, didn't like that I was casting Yoshihara as this big pro-American guy. She was very suspect of that, rightfully so, because I don't think he simply was that. So I've learned that he wasn't just the lone pro-democracy avant-garde artist embracing America while all the Marxists in Tokyo were already on the bandwagon to discredit it and on the reverse course, more communist line of thinking to become what ultimately became a wholeheartedly anti-Americanism. He never was anti-Americanism. But I think that's precisely the point I'm trying to make, is that it's this very complicated, I mean, it's more complicated than love-hate, and it's also more insidious than love-hate, because these powers, these discursive constructions are invisible. That's why they're so insidious.
Okay, echo a fantastic focus on really key questions. And at the moment, you're bringing up a kind of existentialist, my own memory is incredibly relevant here. But it's very important for us, like three generations of interpretation away from this material, to be very careful about us being on the other side of this construction that you so clearly laid out. And to put it in a nutshell, I think from my point of view, someone like Yoshihara would see through Americanism, the Americanism that was being constructed at the same time as he recognized its overall power. And what he would see through to is the actual deep content of the work of someone like Pollock and Klein and de Kooning, which also was not American complicit. Those paintings weren't made to represent America, for Christ's sake. They were then later turned into representations of American culture. But these artists, one artist to another, can actually see the, you know, dislocation and the sense of being both in and against your culture that's within those paintings. So in a sense, that's the concrete connection, I think, that we've got to kind of remember.
Yoshihara's reading of Pollock, when he talks about Pollock, he talks about the materials. He talks about how they look like drops of paint on the surface. He doesn't talk about the sort of subjectivity of Pollock sort of emerging in the same way as we see in the United States. That's a comment, not a question, right? We probably need to move on. Thank you very much.